Miles Davis beat his wife. John Coltrane played around. Charlie Parker was a dope fiend. Billie Holiday a doormat. So much for jazz. Leonardo was gay. Caravaggio a murderer. Picasso misogynist. Pollock a drunk. F. Scott said nigger. And so did Mark Twain. Hemingway was codependent. Jack London hated Chinese. Adios art. So long, literature. Kant treated his maid badly. Kierkegaard was a lousy tipper. Nietzsche said, God is dead. Aristotle sanctioned slavery. Which brings us to the founding fathers. Oh, Washington, Jefferson, poor souls doomed by your time, damned by ours. We wash our hands of you. And what's left when the shadowy gray places are written off in anger, when the paradox of the human soul is rigidly unforgiven. This is a timely one. It's called We Will Have Peace. When conquering extraterrestrials impose it through force, when colors blend beneath the death ray and boundaries and borders disappear and become like feudal fields, when we'll be human beings at last, united like serfs before our lords with our scraps of food, our hovels, our ancient thoughts of freedom. Mm, mm, mm. 21st century Philistines. In the 5th century AD, when the barbarians conquered Rome, they strode up to the Pantheon, muddy boots, bloodied swords, hell-bent on sacking it. But when they stepped inside, they were so stunned by its beauty let it be. And now if they could, 21st century real estate developers would raise it, no problem, to make storage units and call it Pantheon Storage with a picture of its facade on their business cards. Here's an uplifting one. It's called The Mystery of Faith and Dryer Number 3. And this is a true story. Rarely do things malfunction to our benefit. An automobile breaks down. It doesn't suddenly get 90 miles to the gallon. A toaster burns the toast. A wire short circuits. And our house goes up in flames. So it is indeed surprising in this faithless age of innumerable idols and false gods when we come upon something inexplicably benevolent. Such is dryer number 3. For a single quarter, it will run and run, and somehow its 10 minutes of drying time never expires. I watched it once, down to 2 minutes, when suddenly it emitted a joyful beep, and its digital clock leapt to 12 minutes as if through divine intervention. For 2 years, it's been like this. And they come, the pilgrims, with their single quarter as if to lure us to witness a miracle. And for some reason, the owner hasn't found out yet and fixed it. Or perhaps he knows, and he stands back and smiles to himself that his laundromat is blessed. this last one, I'm going to get into the time here. This is called Feminism. I've noticed women uniting to banish the A and the E from man and men and replace it with a Y. Women unite. I understand they're sick of being manipulated, maneuvered, manhandled, and managed by men, and changing the language is one step they're taking. But is this semantic mania manifesting itself in manifold ways really the answer? Or is this mandatory mangling a kind of Pandora's box opening wide? Think of the ramifications. If this manifesto is mandated, will women no longer have manners? Will they still be able to eat mangoes, live in Manhattan, and play the mandolin? Will mannequins be called womenikins? Will they still be able to get manicures and read Thomas Mann? Will love still be a many-splendored thing? Will they ever be able to have a menage a trois, listen to Mendelssohn, or smoke menthol cigarettes? And what about restaurants? How will they order their food? And, dare I say it, menstruation. And when they reach 50-something, will they go through womenopause? What about manic depressives? Personally, I think it's a lot of manure, and they might think me a mental retard or a menace, but I'm going to send them a manuscript in a manila envelope telling them so. When will men and women ever get along, I wonder? Well, there's always mañana. In the meantime, I think I'll move to Manitoba.